Hi, I'm Lynette Pearson with the League of Women Voters. The League is a nonpartisan organization that has provided voters with unbiased election information since 1920. We've invited candidates to talk with us so that you can learn more about them. Joining us now is Knute Buehler, candidate for governor. Welcome, Knute.
Thanks for having me, Lynette.
Can you tell us a little bit about your background briefly?
Yeah, you bet. I was born and raised in Roseburg, Oregon, along with two brothers. We were three sons of a butcher and a homemaker, two people who didn't even graduate from high school. So as you can imagine, they really stressed the importance of getting a really high quality education. I went to Oregon State after that, played baseball there for the Beavers, and then on to medical school in Baltimore, where I met my wife, Patty, who was a classmate. We were married shortly after graduation and then returned to Oregon 28 years ago. And since then, we've been partners in everything we've done, raising two children, supporting one another's medical practice. My wife is an eye surgeon. Starting businesses together, being involved in the Central Oregon community. And now, certainly, we're partners in this run for governor.
Oh, fantastic. First question we have for you. Candidates running for office in Oregon often receive large donations from corporations and out-of-state interests. Is there anything that can be done to limit these contributions besides greater transparency?
Yeah, great question. There's clearly too much money in Oregon politics. I've started my political career in Oregon working on this issue as a young person. I helped write and pass the groundbreaking legislation in 1994 that went to a ballot measure to limit campaign contributions and donations. Unfortunately, it was thrown out by the courts, and so now we have to play by the rules that exist in Oregon. And unfortunately, there's not very many limits whatsoever on campaign donations or spending. I think it's more important in this environment in Oregon that you really look at the actions people take after they're elected into office, no matter where the dollars come from. And when people look at my track record, they'll see one of independence, someone who is willing to break with friends or even party and do what I think is the right thing. And I've done that with regards to being a pro-choice Republican, even though it's a pro-life party. I've certainly broken with my party with regards to such issues as climate change. I was one of the few Republicans who voted for the Coal to Clean bill, where we transitioned Oregon's electrical generation from coal-based energy to more renewables. I've even been one who speaks out frequently against President Trump's political divisiveness. So I think it's better to look at people's record in this current environment in Oregon with regards to campaign donations, especially since the courts have been clear that you can't limit them under current Oregon law.
Yeah. Moving, as you mentioned, the environment, moving on there, and the upcoming discussions that will be happening in 2019 on the cap and trade bill, what climate change measures would you support?
Yeah. I'm certainly against cap and trade, which is Governor Brown's proposal, which would amount to a $1.4 billion tax on energy. I'm against it not because I'm not for doing things for the environment and decreasing our carbon footprint, but I'm against it because it would hit hardworking Oregon families with a sales tax on energy. And unfortunately, way too many people in Oregon are struggling mightily just to pay for the high cost of living here, the high cost of health care, the high cost of child care, of transportation, and this would just add one more thing that I do not think we could support, or they could not pay for it right now.
What would you be able to do then?
You know, I'm more interested in a broad-based revenue-neutral carbon tax that is spread out throughout our economy, and not just concentrated on our manufacturing sector, and importantly, we could offset that with income tax reductions. I think that's a much better policy, much fairer to hardworking Oregonians, and importantly, make an even bigger impact on incentivizing decreased carbon impact in Oregon.
Okay, thank you. Let's see, our education in our schools are always a great concern to our citizens. I know you've spoken at length about that. Specifically, what more can the Oregon government do to support teachers and students in the classroom?
We need to rescue our students, our teachers, our public schools from a classroom funding crisis in Oregon and also a graduation crisis. It is the single biggest failure of Governor Brown's time in office is her indifference to fixing our problems with our public schools, and specifically our classroom funding crisis.
Have ideas on how to fix that?
Meaning absolutely, because we're not getting enough dollars into the classroom right now. Too many of those dollars are going into pension accounts. And what you'll find across school district after school district, despite record school district budgets, we're cutting teachers. 300 teachers face being laid off in Beaverton. Salem District's laying off 67 at a time of record revenue. So as governor, I'll address this where Governor Brown clearly has avoided it, and I'll bring meaningful pension reform. Ideas such as limiting the big $50,000 a month payout some people are getting right now, requiring government employees to actually contribute to their own PERS pension plan. We've been the only state in the nation for a long time that hasn't required that. And importantly, going forward, everyone has transitioned away from PERS into a typical 401k with an employer match. That will put us back on stable financial footing, and importantly, return $1 billion to our budget to be used for other things like improving our graduation rates and having more access to career and technical education.
So you would cap the PERS payments and transition to 401k then?
We would cap the annual payouts, the calculation at say 100,000, and over time transition people to a 401k. Keeping in mind, that would be going forward. Anyone who's earned benefits right now, those benefits can't be changed. The courts have been very clear about that, and I think that's fair.
Okay, all right. Homelessness and affordable housing are two big issues in Oregon. What are your plans on tackling these two issues?
Yeah. Homelessness has become a humanitarian crisis in Oregon, a public health crisis, and increasingly even a public safety crisis. And it's gotten much worse under Governor Brown. Unfortunately, just last month, Oregon was named number one in the nation for the number of homeless youth. Mm-hmm. This is a problem that has to be addressed. It needs to be treated like an emergency. I'll do that. My very first day in office, I'll name a chief homeless solution officer, and we will immediately start working on producing 4,000 emergency temporary shelter beds to get people off the streets, to start getting them the dignity of treatment if necessary, the security of a roof over their head, and the opportunity of a workplace. And that really works. I've traveled the state looking at these programs, and offering compassion along with a little tough love really changes lives.
Okay, and our last couple of minutes here, moving on to another topic quickly. Gun safety is very important to all citizens in Oregon. What gun regulations, if any, would you support along the lines of banning bump stocks or registration of assault weapons, those kind of things?
Yeah. As governor one year, primary duties to keep everyone safe, particularly kids in schools. I've supported good gun safety legislation in the past, just the last legislative session, where I was one of only two Republicans to vote for closing what's called the boyfriend loophole, which allows keeping guns out of the hands of people who've been convicted of domestic abuse or stalking. And I'm willing to support other good ideas like banning bump stocks, preventing people under 21 years of age of buying assault weapons, and importantly, a three-day waiting period on the purchase of handguns, which in other states has really showed a significant decrease in suicides specifically. But let me be clear, I don't think that's going to be enough to keep everyone safe. We also need to invest more in our mental health system. We need to get more resources into our schools for school resource officers and peer-to-peer counseling, and also help law enforcement to do more accurate and rapid and robust background checks. Okay. That combination of things will keep all Oregonians safe.
In our last 30 seconds, is there anything else that you'd like to say to the voters?
Sure. This election is a stark choice, a choice between a status quo governor who has really failed to lead in solving a lot of these important, big, pressing issues in Oregon, like taking care of homelessness, solving our education crisis, making sure health care is affordable for as many Oregonians as possible, versus me, who has a reputation and a track record of leading with an open mind, a caring heart, and a thoughtful voice. And I pledge to Oregonians that I'll be someone who challenges the status quo, will be an independent governor who leads and solves problems for all of Oregonians, no matter who you are, how you're registered to vote, or who you love, or even where you live. And I ask for your vote this November.
Thank you very much, Knute.
Thank you
for coming by.